Hello, good morning. Welcome and selamat datang to the virtual colloquium by Institute of Teacher Education International Languages Campus, or better known as IPGKBA, with the theme Humanizing Teaching and Learning, the Dynamics of Language Education in the Waves of Global Change. I'm Hakima, your moderator for today's session. Welcome again to the 15th session of our virtual colloquium, and I hope you will stay tuned with us till the end of this session. Today, we have a speaker from Sri Lanka, but her heart is always close to Malaysia. Our speaker has been to Malaysia for 3 times, and back in 2018, she was an MTCP ELTC participant. However, before we get to know her, let me lay out a few housekeeping matters. First, everyone who attends to this webinar series will be given an e-certificate after each session. Therefore, don't forget to register yourself and make sure to type accurate email address. The registration link is pinned at the bottom of this YouTube channel. Second, we would love to hear from you during today's presentation. So if you have any questions for our speaker, please feel free to send it through the chat box. The speaker will be answering your questions at the end of the session. And finally, we would like to encourage you to share today's webinar with your social networks. Now, allow me to introduce you our speaker for today, Dr. Sumudu Ebogema. I'm sure you can see her. Hi, Dr. Sumudu Ebogema. Welcome to Kuala Lumpur virtually.
Hi.
Yeah. So Dr. Sumudu Ebogema currently serves the University of Visual and Performing Arts, Sri Lanka. She is a senior lecturer and the head Department of English Language Teaching. To date, she is still a member of Lesson Material Development Team, the Pre-University Online English Language Program. She is also an Action Planning Committee member for the establishment of the University Test for English Language, and she is also a member for the Standing Committee on Teaching English as a Second Language. Now, here is an interesting part about Dr. Ebogema. She recently received the Gold Award for the Academic or Teacher Trainer category for MELTA Excellence in Research Award during the 10th MELTA International Research Conference in English Language Education conducted here in Malaysia. So ladies and gentlemen, without further delay, please welcome Dr. Sumudu Ebogema.
Thank you, Dr. Hakima, for that kind introduction. And thank you very much to the organizing committee for giving me this opportunity to speak at this virtual colloquium. I will warmly welcome you all to this session. And so without any further ado, I would like to start with my topic. As you can see, my topic for today is exploring self-regulated learning among ESL learners following an online English course amidst the COVID-19 pandemic. This study is based on a Sri Lankan undergraduate context. I'm Dr. Sumudu Ebogema, head of the Department of English Language Teaching at the University of Visual and Performing Arts, Sri Lanka. So, why self-regulate? Now, as teachers, we have to understand why we want our students to self-regulate. Basically, to put it very simply, that is being in control of your learning. And as you can see, a self-regulated learner is a strategic learner, is self-determined, resilient, self-aware, and connected. So as teachers, why is this important and what role do we have with regard to enhancing students' self-regulation? Especially in terms of teaching English as a second language, we have to make sure that our students develop the capacity to acquire the language even in an online context. And for that, self-regulation is very crucial. So moving on, my presentation will be delivered in 3 parts. And initially, I will just give you an introduction to what self-regulated learning is. and why it is important, especially with regard to teaching English as a second language. Then I will just move on to my study and talk about my study in detail at that point. Finally, as a practitioner myself, I would like to share with you some good practices for promoting self-regulated learning, especially when it comes to an online learning context. So, what is self-regulated learning? Now, there are many definitions given to this, and one of the main researchers with regard to this area of study is Zimmerman. And so basically, regulation means regulating one's thinking and actions, the capacity to regulate one's thinking and actions. Self-regulated learner employs metacognitive, motivational, and behavioral processes to achieve a specific learning and performance goal. Such a learner actively engages in these processes using specific strategies, which we call self-regulated learning strategies. So self-regulated learning is a core conceptual framework. It is there to understand the cognitive, metacognitive, motivational, and emotional aspects of learning. So it is like an umbrella term which covers all these aspects. And when we talk about, when we look at the components of self-regulated learning, mainly you have metacognition, cognition, motivation, and behavior. So it is to do with this, that self-regulated learning involves all these elements. So when we look at it, as I just want to look at it separately. So as Zimmerman states, self-regulated learning is it's in response to metacognitive awareness of a gap between performance and goals, and it's driven by self-efficacy and the will to improve. The learner implements initial changes in learning strategies. So it is all to do with the learners, in this case, self-regulated. We are talking about self-regulated learning among our students, and it is to do with the way in which they control their learning experience, basically. So when you talk about metacognition and cognition, the learner here, we are saying, is aware of the gaps between one's own performance and the target outcomes. And the learner knows how and when to use various learning strategies appropriately, right? And they learn how to set goals, plan how to meet these goals, implement these goals effectively while monitoring and evaluating their progress. And motivation, as you know, is very crucial for any learner. So the learner, in this case, a self-regulated learner, reports high levels of self-efficacy. And the learner is intrinsically motivated and interested in learning. So when you talk about motivation, you know that when it comes to intrinsic motivation, that is what really the self-regulated learner is inclined towards. Because intrinsic motivation means that they are learning for the love of learning, not merely because of external benefits or rewards. So this kind of self-regulated learner is highly intrinsically motivated. And these learners learn autonomously and maintains accountability as well. And when you talk about behavior, self-regulated learners are effective. They can effectively control their behavior as well. They do this by seeking information and advice from others when they are learning. Also, they manage to optimize their study environment, right? And they can find ways of, especially now, you know, because of the COVID crisis, most of our learners are compelled, at least in Sri Lanka, they are still working, learning from home. So regulating the study environment is crucial, and a self-regulated learner puts in a lot of effort to do this effectively. So what are the, now we have discussed some of the key characteristics, which I now am highlighting in this slide. Self-regulated learners, as I mentioned earlier, are motivated learners, and they are capable of reflecting on the process of learning itself. and they attribute their success or failure to factors in their control. They don't feel that the learning experience is something that is totally dependent on how the teacher delivers the lesson or what the course content is. They feel responsible for their own learning, and they are capable of taking control and ownership for their learning. And that is through the deployment of autonomy. And, you know, they feel that they are empowered as learners to take control of their learning. So they can employ multiple strategies for learning as well. They can evaluate their learning against set standards, like maybe a rubric or benchmark. So when they are in a position, the self-regulated learner is in a position to really realize what are the weaknesses that I have and what are the strengths that I have as a learner. And they can plan when they are given a task, they know how to use the correct strategies to plan their learning. They can monitor and regulate their learning without external persons involved in the process. They have the capacity to regulate their own learning. So these are some of the main characteristics of a self-regulated learner. Now, so we are really now focusing on, in my study at least, and in this presentation, how self-regulation happens in an online learning environment. Because of the crisis that we are facing, and we are still facing the COVID pandemic, right? Our students have been forced to study using distance learning modes. So especially when it comes to regulation, self-regulation, we know this is really crucial in an online environment. In a classroom environment, there is regulation done by the environment itself. The teacher is present, the classroom environment is there, and there is regulation in that sense. But when a student is learning in an online environment, the student, him or herself, has to engage in a lot of regulation in order to ensure that the learning takes place properly. So we can talk, when you talk about self-regulation, autonomy is very crucial. So the students should feel empowered, and they should feel that they have the freedom to really, select what they want to learn, learn the proper way, and select the correct strategies that would work in a particular context. And according to many studies that have been done with regard to self-regulated learning, we have found that autonomous learners perform better, obviously, right, than those who are not. Lack of self-regulation, on the other hand, is one of the main reasons for students to abandon online courses. So the presence of self-regulated skills can be a major denominator to be successful in online courses. Technology, as we know, has limitations, right? But as teachers, we feel that we have to transcend the barrier of the virtual screen that we have been confronted with in order to approach our students, and the students feel the same way. But we have to also acknowledge the fact that technology has a lot to offer students with regard to self-learning and activities that are there for them to develop their study skills. In this case, they are English language skills. So when we look at the background to the study that I did, it was done in a situation or a context which is, as I mentioned earlier, which resulted as a result of the COVID pandemic that has affected our whole world. And so this was the program that we had been delivering at the university where the study was conducted. The course was offered through an online platform. And this was an alternative educational delivery mode. And this course traditionally was offered through face-to-face means. But because of the crisis response initiative, we were compelled to convert the course into an online program. So in both face-to-face instruction and online instruction, we all know that the pedagogical intent is to teach. But as we know, there are fundamental differences between the two modes. And can you think of what the main difference or the main most fundamental difference between the two modes is? I would say that the biggest difference is that there's lack of presence of the teacher in the classroom. There is the lack of physical connectivity among the students and the teacher. So the in a virtual environment, that physical presence is missing. So most of the, as a response to this crisis situation, we call this emergency remote teaching and learning. So during this emergency remote teaching and learning period, a lot of the teachers and, you know, administrators in educational institutions tended to focus on, you know, the curricula and how to revise the curricula and the lesson content and make it adaptable to the online environment. However, I feel that, you know, sometimes we in this process seem to have missed the focus of our main stakeholder, I would say, that is our student. So student-related factors, and are we really looking at the student's perspective when it comes to this kind of online learning context, which has been given to them without, of course, much planning, because the onset of the COVID pandemic was very sudden. So so the self-regulatory things, like, you know, looking at whether the students are self-regulated, are they engaged in the courses that we are offering in an online mode? All these things have to be considered as well, apart from looking at what we are delivering as teachers to these students. So self-regulatory skills, such as the amount and effort and organization exerted during the learning, can be a major denominator to be successful in online courses. So we have to, I felt that we need to find out whether these students are actually self-regulated in an online context. So the research objectives, basically it was to identify the presence of self-regulated learning among a group of students learning English as a second language through fully online modes during emergency remote learning. And finally, the second objective, not really finally, but secondly, I wanted to, you know, look at the study findings and based on that, maybe provide suggestions to ESL teachers on how self-regulated learning support can be given to students in similar learning contexts. Because you know that self-regulation, we say this is an internalized phenomenon, but it doesn't have to be really totally to do with some, you know, the personality of the student, the motivation and the way they think about the learning process. It can actually be taught. So that is where our role as teachers come in. So methods and instrumentation. So for the research, my model was Zimmerman's cyclical phases model with regard to self-regulated learning. And as you can see here, according to Zimmerman, there are three phases, and these three phases are interconnected and they are cyclic. So the ability to self-regulate one's learning develops in a cyclical nature as the interaction of personal, behavioral, and environmental factors all work together, right? So when we talk about this forethought phase, this is what is called this is where the students analyze the tasks, set goals, plan how to reach them, and a number of, you know, using their motivation to and the drive to learn. And this is also where they try to think of what kind of learning strategies would work to accomplish a particular task. And then moving on to the performance phase, that is where they actually execute the task. And while they are executing the task, they will monitor their progress. They will be aware of where, you know, they are faltering and make corrections. They will evaluate and, you know, they will use various strategies to finish the tasks that they have been assigned. So self-reflection phase is really important as well, because after the performance phase, once they complete a learning task, they engage in self-reflection. So to do that, then they think about how they perform the task and whether they were successful in doing so. And if they failed, why did they fail? So it can be either, you know, the self, their self-realization could be positively or negatively influenced by the way that they have been engaging in the task during the performance phase in terms of whether they were capable of reaching their goals or not. So this model was, this is quite a popular model when it comes to self-regulated learning. So this model was used for the study. And I would just like to quickly go through the strategies now. I was mentioning that self-regulated learning involves various strategies on the part of students that they have to employ. So in the study, I focused on six such SRL strategies. So one is goal setting. So goal setting means the setting of educational goals or sub-goals in order to exert the effort required to achieve those goals. Goal setting involves selecting personal learning standards for short and long-term learning goals. Self-evaluation is another strategy where, you know, the students are capable of setting quality standards and criteria for progress to judge one's own performance. Activities for monitoring the learning process in relation to defining learning goals is done during this particular strategy, when they are employing this particular strategy. Task strategies, as the name implies, talks about activities and activities that they engage in to improve persistence and effort regulation in the face of academic challenges. This can include behaviors to curtail distractions to learning, such as taking notes, reading aloud, preparing questions, and pursuing extra work. Environmental structuring, it is looking at the environment, the physical environment, and rearranging it to avoid distractions and enhance learning. Time management is also crucial for self-regulation. So allocating, scheduling, and distributing time for learning is crucial, and a good self-regulated learner knows how to manage his or her own time. And finally, help seeking, that is asking other people for help when they need it, such as from the instructors or their peers, or even consulting external help and various resources. Especially in an online context, this is crucial because, as I mentioned before, there is the physical presence of the teacher is absent, and even the peers are not present during the learning experience. So this is really crucial when it comes to self-regulated learning, seeking help. And as we know, when it comes to online learning, there are many ways of, apart from approaching teachers and peers, there are many resources available online for them to get this extra help. So this study, it was an exploratory, I used an exploratory research design and used the mixed methods approach. And the participants of my study were first year undergraduates, and this course, who were following an online course. The name of the course is English for General and Academic Purposes. It was a beginner's level program, and it is compulsory for these students who are undergraduates to pass this course. All participants involved in the research were assured of anonymity and confidentiality and were well aware of the fact that it was voluntary. The study setting was, it was at a faculty that produced performing arts graduates in the fields of dance and drama. And as I mentioned earlier, the course delivery, it was done, the delivery was online. And you know, when we were teaching these students in this particular group, we used synchronous as well as asynchronous teaching methods. By which I mean, synchronous means we use the Zoom platform, and the teachers directly have a time scheduled for lecturing and teaching the students so that they learn the lessons. And asynchronous teaching happened when they were given material and additional resources through the use of the university LMS and also links to other websites and videos that were educational. So they learned through asynchronous means as well. The quantitative study component, so when you talk about that, is the study sample. There were 193 students who responded to the survey that was done. And out of the participants, 86% were females and 14% were males. And this is not surprising because at the university, at this particular faculty, the majority of students are females. And their ages range from 20 to 23, and the majority belong to the age group of 21, followed by 22 years of age. The sampling was purposive sampling, and data collection was done using the short version of the online self-regulated learning questionnaire, which is also called the OSLQ, which was developed by Lan and his associates. This questionnaire consisted of 24 items, and responses were given using a 5-point Likert scale, where strongly agree received the highest rating of 5, and strongly disagree was denoted the minimum score of 1 mark. So the data collection for that, 6 self-regulated learning strategies were measured, the 6 that I mentioned previously in one of my previous slides, and this was done through the deployment of the OSLQ. So namely, we were looking at goal setting, time management, self-evaluation, environmental setting, task strategies, and help seeking. The analysis, so in terms of the analysis, the Google form was shared with the participants, and the based on the sheet that was generated, we calculated the individual mean scores for each strategy, and we did this by averaging the ratings of the corresponding items. There were 6 items. So to measure the overall presence of SRL, a composite mean score was computed by averaging mean scores for all strategies. So major findings of the OSL after the deployment of the OSLQ, that is the online self-regulated strategies questionnaire. So you can see the mean scores generated for each self-regulated strategy under consideration. Here you can see the highest mean score was granted for goal setting with a mean score of 4.37, followed closely by environmental setting with a mean score of 4.31. Then time management was present with 4.21, help seeking received a mean score of 4.19, and task strategies that received the least, this is a 5th variable. So this received a mean score of 4.15, and the least common strategy employed was self-evaluation, which received 4.07. But you can see that in terms of the mean scores generated, they are above 4, that's out of 5, which means that considerably, in general, when we look at the findings, we can see that the sample that was studied were highly regulated learners. So with regard to the total mean score generated, it was 4.20. So I told you that now, in order to validate the findings of the quantitative study component, I had a focus group discussion with a group of volunteer students taken from the same sample. So 12 volunteer online ESL learners following this first year English course, that is 8 females and 4 males, were involved in the discussion. And the purposive sampling techniques was used here as well. And the focus group discussion was conducted, and analysis was the responses were thematically analyzed. And based on the findings of this focus group discussion, we can see that when we ask the students, right now, how did you self-regulate? The main reasons they gave for their high sense of self-regulation are presented here. So they pointed out that the flexibility of learning, that they were given the opportunity, I mentioned earlier also, they had the opportunity of learning synchronously as well as asynchronously. And they even the sessions that were done live with the students, the recordings we made sure were available to them through the University LMS in case they did not have the opportunity of following the lesson at the given time. And they felt that their lessons were well designed and compatible with the online environment. The lessons were very visually appealing to them, and we used many different methods like PowerPoint, video, audio, and various links were given to them, and the lessons themselves were well planned. Then availability of online resources, so we made sure that students understood that there were ample resources when available online, and we gave them the links or the relevant guidance to use these technological tools whenever they can. Task-based activities are often introduced during the teaching process, and we also encourage peer and self-evaluation, and they felt that that also helped develop their self-regulation. Opportunities for help seeking were there for the students because they get to contact the teachers when they needed help, and also they had a lot of peer interaction. For example, we would often put them when we are teaching using Zoom, they can go into breakout rooms, they can do their group work there, and then they can talk to their friends and get help for various things that they do not understand. They can seek help from their peers. Scaffolding took place where the teachers would give them models and explain something. Model answers will be provided, and then the teachers would get them to do something by themselves and produce it. So teachers encouraging persons is also, they felt, a contributing factor for feeling that they are positively self-regulated. Teachers encouraging persons, as we know, the theme of the colloquium is humanizing education, and this is very important, especially in a virtual environment, because the students have to not feel isolated in the learning experience in an online platform. The teachers should make sure that the students know that you are available to them. And what we do is, of course, we give them contact details. They can approach us. There are discussion forums that are happening. They have been given opportunities to approach us through various WhatsApp groups and things like that. So the teacher is constantly present. And even the presence is felt during the synchronous session, where they meet the teachers at least 4 times a week for 1.5 sessions. So it is live, and they meet the teacher and get to talk to the teacher and interact with the teacher, even though it is within the limitations of an online space. Of course, the students were given deadlines so that they can manage their time, especially when they are assigning them a task and when to complete it. With regard to assessments also, we tried to break larger projects into smaller sections so that the students can they do not feel overwhelmed, right, and that they can then manage one component at a time before finishing the overall project. For example, if we give them a problem solution project, where then they would first have to come up with a problem, identify it, then problem statement, then followed by finding solution for it. So breaking an assessment into different components really helps these students to learn as well, and that helps them to control their learning experience because they do not feel overwhelmed, as I mentioned before. So the tasks are manageable. That is why they feel that way. So these were some of the real main reasons that they gave for feeling empowered and autonomous as learners, even if the classes are being conducted virtually. So to move on to the discussion, so we can note that this particular group of students were highly self-regulated, which means that they appear to use acceptable learning strategies that positively contribute to their experience of developing the second language, that is English. So they have, I think, been effective in setting goals and striving to reach them by perseverance and the balancing of psychological factors such as goal setting and self-evaluation alongside physical factors such as environmental structuring and help seeking. Because the lecturers encourage and promote learner autonomy, they feel empowered and as a result responsible for their learning processes. By assigning students group projects, employing task-based learning, students have been encouraged to set goals in order to complete these activities, which have been well explained to them in advance with modeling and scaffolding. Students attempt to set their learning pace, which in turn demonstrates their commitment and motivation to develop English. acknowledging they also acknowledge that seeking help from their peers and teachers is important during distance learning, especially since they are physically removed from the presence of teachers and friends. Having designated times assigned for English and clear guidelines and deadlines for submissions have supported the development of time management skills among these learners. Task strategies and self-evaluation were the least present, as you noticed from the findings. So both these factors which are relating to, you know, students' persistence may have been affected by the fact that the sample consisted largely of low proficiency ESL learners. So just concluding remarks for the study that I have done. So we can say that online education, obviously there are limitations, but there are many, many positive things as well that come out of it. So online education not only transcends the limitations of place, time, and physical materials, but also is a congenial environment for promoting greater learner autonomy during the study process, as students have greater control of what, where, how, and when to study or to learn. Also, to become self-regulators, what has been considered as the most significant contributors are the activities that have promoted their self-regulated learning, including constant guidance and encouragement by teachers, enhanced sense of learner autonomy, and the awareness of the accessibility of extensive ESL learning resources through the internet. So how can teachers promote self-regulated learning? So this is the third part of my presentation where, okay, self-regulated learning, we can promote it explicitly and implicitly. Explicitly, by which I mean, as teachers, we can directly impart knowledge regarding the self-regulated strategies that some of which I have already mentioned, and explain how they can learn these strategies. How, for example, help seeking is important. Time management is important. So by explaining directly to the students the importance of learning self-regulated learning strategies, we can enhance their self-regulation. Also, implicitly also, because we have to internalize self-regulated learning. So not just instructing them directly, but also taking the time to design our modules in such a way that it promotes the application of self-regulated learning strategies. So to do that, we have to present a clear picture to the students about what our program is, what are our expectations, what are our learning objectives, so that students are fully aware of them in order to set the goals straight, because they need to set goals in order to reach the target. So maintaining, you know, online blog entries, journal entries, having study plans, self-evaluation reports. These things can promote self-regulation among the students. Using scaffolding techniques also, as I mentioned, as the teachers, we need to scaffold. We need to really, scaffolding techniques could mean explicit instructions, giving them examples, giving them sample answers, and providing them with the examples so that they can produce something on their own. So we are giving the initial support to them, and that will help them to develop their learning. So we also introduce graded assessments at regular intervals. So that is done. And when it comes to assessments, you need to give them the rubric. You have to make them clear as to what the teacher expects from them, so that they know that, okay, this is what I have to do. So getting students to self-evaluate and also peer review their work, which we did, so could also be a contributing factor to the positive presence of SRL in this particular group. Providing various options for, you know, help, as I mentioned, you know, giving the teachers contact details, getting them to approach the teacher directly or their students, having discussion forums, having groups where you can, you know, chat and share your concerns, and, you know, if you need help, ask for help, setting deadlines for assignments and their work, and regular prompting and encouragement. Because just at the start of a course, if the teacher goes on about how important self-regulated learning is, that wouldn't do. You have to constantly remind them and make sure that they are self-regulated by, you know, intermittently or actually from time to time introducing or reminding them about the importance of self-regulation. To sum up, Given the high attrition rates in online courses, it is high time that educators recognize the importance of fostering self-regulated learning among students and making them feel empowered agents in their learning process. Empowering students with tools needed to be successful and active learners, rather than just as for them to behave as passive sponges, that will lead to more fulfilling and productive educational experiences. So to make them active learners and not just receiving whatever the teacher tells them as a passive sponge. Further studies also, I would encourage the teachers here and all the educators to engage in similar studies. So actually you can do more extensive studies and study the presence of SRL among your own students and see whether it is present or not and what is missing and what is actually there. Students with internal accountability beliefs generally perform better than students with external locus of control in online courses. As the online learning environment is characterized by autonomy, self-regulation becomes a critical factor for success in online learning. So I would like to just finish my presentation by really bringing to you the focus of what I have been talking about by saying that learning is not something that happens to students. It is something that happens by students. Thank you.
Wow, what an insightful sharing by Dr. Semudo. Thank you so much, Dr. Semudo. If I were to summarize the two keywords that you to summarize the whole sharing session in addressing the teaching and learning in the pandemic situation currently, you are proposing that teachers need to give autonomy, number one, and number two, accountability for learners to make sure that they can successfully complete the online lessons.
Yes, definitely.
So these are the two keywords, yeah, autonomy and accountability. So if I may use this platform to ask you one further question, I also listed down some of the key findings that you mentioned. So not only autonomy, accountability, there's also an element of flexibility in learning. And you also put there that teachers need to provide clear guidelines and also deadlines when it comes to completing the tasks. So can you elaborate on that? What do you mean when you say clear guidelines and deadlines?
Yes, okay, thank you. And yes, you have really captured the whole essence of what I have presented. When you say clear guidelines, for example, when you assign students a task, you need to, as the teacher, initially explain to them what is expected as the outcome of a task. Let's say that you want to get them to develop an essay, academic essay. And so when you are talking about guidelines, you have to first, you can't suddenly tell them, okay, now this is the topic and go ahead and write it. But you have to start with the pre-writing skills and what are they? And then, break it down in such a way that you start with the pre-writing activities, you scaffold it, you teach them what pre-writing is. And then that task, once it's completed, then they can move on to the next part of the essay, which is the outline, like that, and also when you talk, so even a task, if you can break it down and make it more simple and straightforward, students understand it better than when you give the whole thing at once. Also, when you say guidelines, you need to give them the ILO, so the intended learning outcomes of an activity, right? Mm-hmm. And also when you say guidelines, when it comes to assessments, you have to provide them the clear rubric so that they know, okay, how do I get 10 marks? 10 out of 10 is this, if you do this, you get 10 out of 10. Those are the ways that you can provide clear guidelines. Did that answer your question? I think you talked about guidelines, and what was the next thing that you asked?
Deadlines.
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 Yes. Yes, you see, especially now we use the LMS quite extensively. I'm sure that happens in Malaysia as well. So when we especially when it comes to assessments, we have to set deadlines. So even group projects, tasks, we have to say, okay, you need to submit this, during this particular period. And this is the submission date. So that they know, okay, without just saying, okay, you have to do this. Once you set a deadline, they know, okay, I have to strive towards reaching this deadline. And especially in an online context, you know, they can't submit an assignment later on because the system monitors it, so that it will be rejected. So time management really happens in that sense in a virtual environment. So setting and giving them even a deadline would give them an idea when they are expected to finish the task.
Okay, so as a teacher, this is a takeaway for today. We need to have a clear idea first and foremost what to assign for the students so that they can complete the task, and that task becomes a vehicle for them to fulfill the learning outcome, the intended learning outcome. Right. For your information, Dr. Sumudu, in Malaysia currently, we are actually promoting, the Ministry of Education in Malaysia, we are promoting a classroom-based assessment rather than the formal, formal examination at the end of the semester. So from your own experience, Dr. Sumudu, in handling assessment, yeah, perhaps you can share with us some tips or strategies how to go about when not only the teachers need to design assessment online, but they need to mark it online and give it back online.
Okay, yes. So when we talk about assessments, yeah, you there's formative and summative, and especially yes, even in Sri Lanka, in an online environment, summative assessments really they do not work well in an online context, as you know. So to introduce more formative assessments, having continuous assessments after probably even each module would be really beneficial for the students, because then having these kind of continuous assessments will keep them engaged as well, so that you don't get the, in a virtual environment, the students can easily go out of a session just by clicking a button or by touching the screen. So in that sense, to keep them engaged, you have to constantly, introduce various tasks and assessments. One thing is to find out whether they really understand what they are learning, and also to for them to realize that they are progressing. So when they do these assessments, then they end up realizing, okay, I am able to do this, so I will do this. What we do here is, rather than now giving them individual assignments, we try to give them group projects so that they work as a group. Even if it is virtually, they will be assigned into groups. And also we would give them, as you know, I'm sure you use these applications as well. You know, we use Padlet a lot so that they can engage in collaborative learning and, present it. Or they can, there is a new Wakelet is there, Wakelet. So, Wakelet will provide them even more opportunities to kind of engage collaborative sharing activities. I noticed that the students really prefer that rather than working in isolation. So strategies like that have worked for us, where they submit group projects and do it in a collaborative manner, as long as we provide them the guidance and support, that then it'll work in that sense.
Okay, so that leaves us to the idea of collaborative and cooperative learning, but we can embed that as our attempt to assess the students as well, yeah, in the classroom. Yeah, right. Definitely. So that remark by Dr. Sumudu concludes this webinar. Thank you all for your participation and comments. We hope you have learned and enjoyed this session as much as I do. I would like to thank our speaker, Dr. Sumudu Abukama, the Studio Director Encik Syarul Azhar Ali, the producer of EduWeb TV, Dr. Suraz Kanagasabai, the Educational Technology Division's Ministry of Education Malaysia, also the our 16th webinar series will be held tomorrow, October 21st, yeah, Thursday tomorrow, mark your calendar. It will be live at 3 p.m. Malaysia time, and this is the hint, UK time at 8 a.m. Till then, jumpa lagi, see you again, and goodbye from Kuala Lumpur.